good stuff in James. I didn't want to fly through all the meat to have just like, well, you know, I wish we could talk about that more, but we got to finish this in just a couple weeks. So we're going to spend a significant amount of time in James, and that starts today. Now, before we go, so let me, I can't, I need to break open this Bible. It won't stay open, so all right, here we go. All right. So we're still dealing with the pandemic, and I don't know about you, but there's a couple things that I'm tired of hearing. I'm tired of hearing who is and is not an expert, right? I'm tired of just the constant tension and conflict and division over everything. It's driving me nuts. And there's a phrase that I could go the rest of my life without hearing, and that is new normal, right? We're living as a new normal. So in grandiose fashion, we titled this series New Normal. So we're going to hear that a whole bunch as we're studying James. Because the book of James, it really centers on this idea of changing and what it looks like to move from what you were like or what life was like to what life should be like now that you are a follower and disciple of Jesus, right? Now, I know that people don't really like change, okay? It's a hard thing to wrestle with. So when you hear new normal, it rubs you wrong because you want things to kind of stay the way they are. Sometimes change is a good thing. It means growth, right? It's a good thing that we're not all still wearing diapers, right? We all grew past that when we were a child. It's a good thing that we all learned our, you know, multiplication tables, right? So we don't need calculators in our pockets on our phone, you know? So there are some things it's good to grow and to know and learn. I know sometimes change, you don't even realize it's happening. It just kind of sneaks up on you, right? Like the fair. Like when you're a kid and you drive past the fair, you're like, oh my goodness, it's a roller coaster. I want to ride the roller coaster. When you're an adult, you're like, oh my goodness, is that on a trailer? Is that, does that have all the bolts attached to it? Is the guy running that a structural engineer? Like, can I see your resume before I put my child on this thing that you brought with your truck? All right, it's a completely different mindset, and we've changed, and it just kind of snuck up on us. But there are things for sure that change in our life where we choose to change. When we deliberately make a choice in our life to bring dramatic, extravagant, whole life change into our normal routine and circumstance, and we even when we know that there are going to be challenges, we accept it. We choose it. We want it. Like, if you have an opportunity to shift from one job to a better job, and you're like, this job's gonna be better for my family, I may have to move, you know, I may have to change positions, I may have to make a big change in our life, but I'm willing to accept that and all that comes along with that because of, you know, the perceived benefits, okay? That's a time where we are choosing to bring, you know, catalytic change to our life, right? What about marriage? That's another one, right? You chose to bring another person into your life and all the complications that brings. And so you've said, yes, I'm choosing this change because of the benefits that I believe will exist in this relationship, but also because of, you know, there's emotions involved and there's all the components that are good. And even though you know and have probably seen some marriages not be great, you're taking that risk, right, and believing the best in it. So you're accepting all the risks, all the challenges, all the rewards, all of that as a package deal without even knowing what really is to come. There's this hope, and so you choose to change and get married. Another big one is kids, right? If you choose to have children, see, this is the thing, like, if you want to have children, you get around people who have children, they're young, that might be one of the best birth control methods, right? Just be around other people with kids, because you're just like, somebody said preach, because you see it's like, wow, I'm choosing that, you know, I'm going to bring that into my life, right? But kids can be a huge, massive change, and you're bringing into this routine changes. I mean, when kids are, you're changing your sleep habits and patterns, like how you communicate. You're looking at things in your life, and you're saying, you know, I probably should stop doing this for to be a father or to be a better example to my kids. You're making choices based on a decision you made to change. Well, that is true in our spiritual life as well, and our faith. In fact, God doesn't want us to stay the same. I mean, you may have heard the phrase, God accepts you as you are, right? Sure, come as you are, but you can't stay that way, right? Like the whole idea of coming to God is choosing to, what did Jesus say? Like, if you're going to be my disciple, you have to what? You have to take up your cross, you have to deny yourself, die to yourself. You have to choose to change. If you're going to follow me, you have to choose to change. And you're accepting all the challenges and all of the risks because there is this perceived reward and salvation and hope and peace and joy. Well, that is really the argument in the letter of James. So we're going to walk through this book over the next several weeks. We're going to see all of the amazing insights and tidbits of wisdom. In fact, Charles Swindoll actually calls James, he said it looks like a bit like the Old Testament book of Proverbs dressed up in New Testament clothes because it's filled with commands to change and pursue holiness. The letter focuses on action. It focuses on proof that God's love has changed you, right? We say that all the time. And that you are able to prove that by that love and by that change that you can love others and that God's love is relevant for them as well. So for James, we're reading his letter, if your faith isn't backed up by action, proof, then it's probably a worthless faith, or you're lying about your faith. And that's the immediate gut punch of truth that comes with the book of James, why so many people have had a hard time with the book of James, because it very quickly and very aggressively just kind of comes at you and says, hey, you say you follow Jesus, you say you love Jesus, you say you have faith, prove it. Now, we use that word and we talk about it all the time. And so it's fitting that we're here, especially after we just talked about the chesed of God, what it is for God to demonstrate that to us, and then for us to be the image bearers of God and then prove that we believe in that chesed and we trust that chesed and that we're going to live it out as best we can. Even though it's an impossible task, it is a relentless pursuit that we choose every day because of the change that the Holy Spirit has brought into our life, right? So that's really the book of James. We'll talk more about it in the next couple weeks, but we're going to look at just one verse today, the very first verse. Before we do, let's just talk about James as a person. Let's just get to know James, okay? He is the half-brother of Jesus, right? There's a lot of things that connect that. We can talk about that. We'll talk about that. But that's interesting to me right off the bat because he grew up with Jesus as the older brother. And I mean, I was the older brother in my house, and now that I have kids and I watch the older brother in our house be the third parent. Does anybody else have a third parent in their house? Okay, so I was probably that growing up in my house too. And I'm thinking, like, was Jesus the third parent? Was Jesus the third parent in the house? Like, James, you need to make your bed. I'm like, Jesus, I don't feel like making my bed. I made my bed. James, you need to make your bed. Mary said, mother said, you need to eat your peas. Come on, Jesus, stop it. I don't like the peas. Eat your peas, James. Like, what did Jesus do? Like, how? Like, what kind of childhood were all the other brothers and sisters growing up in with the third parent of Jesus? You know, it's like, hey, Jesus, you know, Jesus did it. You should do it too. Ugh, you know, I'm tired of the what would Jesus do in my house. All right, so we get James as the half-brother of Jesus, and that's awesome. But then later on, and when he's writing this letter, he is a leader in the church. In Acts 15, there's the Jerusalem Council, if you're familiar with that. There was a lot of discussion about what the Gentiles should do or should not do because they weren't Jews. They didn't have the heritage and the teachings and the ties to the Mosaic law. And so James is the one who kind of led the decision that, well, all right, so if the Gentiles will just respect a couple things that really are kind of make or break for us to interact with them, then they don't have to follow all of the Mosaic laws. It doesn't really apply to them. And so he's there with Peter and Paul and other apostles that are there. But James really kind of led that decision in Acts 15. He's spoken of by Peter and Paul in their letters as an influencer, as a faithful leader in the church by the early church fathers, to see him as a prominent leader in the early church, especially in Jerusalem. In fact, this letter is probably one of, if not the first letters that were written and put in circulation with all the churches, Jewish churches and Gentile churches, coming from James as kind of the head of the church in the capital in Jerusalem. So he's got an amazing pedigree. He's got an incredible position, right? But he was not always a believer. In fact, if you look at John chapter 7, verse 5, it specifically says, his brother, it says that his family, he was there with his family, and his brothers were telling Jesus to basically tone it down, bro. Tone it down, all right? Maybe if you say that you're these things, you can do all this stuff, then you could just do it when we say to do it. But really, we don't believe that this is true. So probably better if you just tone it down. So they say in John 7:5, it says specifically, his brothers did not believe. James being a brother, his brothers did not believe. But even more critical, I think, in Mark chapter 3, it says that his brothers and his family said that in trying to come up with a defense of why he was behaving this way, and people were like, aren't you his family? Isn't this your brother? They said he is, quote, out of his mind. They say he was crazy. Like, is that Jesus? Yeah, but he's a little nuts, all right? That, yes, he is our brother, but he's out of his mind. He's out of his mind. That's where he was as an adult. Jesus is out of his mind. I do not believe that he is who he says he is. So somewhere between that and writing this letter, James chose to make a change. What happened? Well, he saw his brother die. Then he saw his brother come back to life. And at that point, maybe he started to question whether his "you're crazy and I don't believe" was the right position and platform to stand on, right? I mean, I don't know about you, but if I had a brother who died and came back to life, right, and I watched him ascend into heaven, I'm like, you know what? You know what? Maybe he was telling the truth. maybe I should have listened better. So he chooses to change. He says, wait, no, I do believe. I do believe. And this is where I want you to see. So look at this. Look at James chapter 1, verse 1. It says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he says who he's greeting this to. He says, to the 12 tribes in the diaspora or the dispersion, greetings. That's how he starts the letter off. But this is how he starts it. This is the half-brother of Jesus who didn't believe, who said Jesus was out of his mind, and he opens his letter and he says, I am a servant of God and of Jesus the Messiah. Of Jesus, my half-brother, who I'm now telling you, I believe, is the anointed one of God, sent to bring us salvation and hope, the one we have been longing for and speaking of and hearing about for our entire lives and our forefathers' lives. Like, we've been waiting for this person, and he was in my house, and I did not believe, and I thought he was crazy, but I'm telling you now, for the record, I now serve him, my brother, my Lord, God, the Messiah, Jesus. Now, I don't don't know, like, and you could probably think there's probably people in your life where you're just like, that person's crazy. That person's out of their mind. That person, I would never trust that person. I would never. And you can have that emotion, like whatever would bring you to some place to not trust someone, or to not believe in someone, or to not think that that person would have value or could be trusted or relied upon, right? To think that person was crazy. And what it would take to shift your mindset to a point to where you don't, not only do you not think they're crazy anymore, and not only do you not trust them, or however the right way to say that is, but now you want to go and just pour yourself out and love on them and serve them and give everything you have to them, almost as a means of saying, I'm sorry, I'm now devoting my life to prove that I believe in you. And that's what James did. And that shift was James choosing to change, choosing to say goodbye to his old self, which was no hope, which was false truth, and changing to follow Jesus and believe wholeheartedly. Now, the weight of this, sure, we can get in our minds and we can think, that having a thought about someone being crazy or not trusting them, maybe we can wrap our mind around that. But there's more weight in the statement, because when he says a servant, he's using a word in the Greek that's important for us to understand. The word is doulos. All right, say doulos. Doulos. Y'all speak Greek. That's awesome. So doulos is a very interesting word, because it's difficult to bring it into the English. One of those words where it's one word in the Greek that means many things, and trying to bring it into the English is hard. So we have to look at what's happening around it to really understand the context. Now, let me tell you why it's difficult. Let me tell you why translators and people who are bringing the Greek into English or any other language will spend painstaking hours over this particular word and the context surrounding it. Because this word and its Hebrew equivalent, ebed, is translated properly as slave, like one who is owned as property and traded or bartered or treated as such. Now we know that the institution of slavery and the evil that exists in that, the dehumanizing and horrible posturing of that institution, as we understand it today, you're going to take great pains to make sure, if you're saying slave, that you mean slave. So there are plenty of occasions where there are instances, like in Romans 6, when it means someone who is owned like property, and it will be translated slave. But then there are other times when there is more flexibility and maybe some freedom. Maybe it's a choice for a temporary paying off of debt, and you might get servant or bond servant. So in the Old Testament, there's a lot more actual property slavery mentioned. In fact, so much so that the Old Testament Mosaic law has very specific provisions and protections for anyone in servitude. In the New Testament, because you're under Roman Empire rule this time, there are plenty of slaves treated very, very poorly in Roman history, but there's also what would be known as a bond servant, where someone has basically made a contract, because either they have a debt they cannot pay monetarily, or they owe something to someone, and so they've given themselves in servitude for a period of time, 7 years, and in many cases 14 years if you're actually in Caesar's court, to be a slave or a bond servant for a period of time. But that was temporary. So you got to distinguish. That's where it becomes challenging, because now you have to distinguish between slave forever, you're owned, your property, you're treated in this very dehumanizing way, versus still, you know, not a great situation, but something that where someone has sort of stepped into it, like, I can't repay this, and so now I'm offering my personhood to pay this debt, but it's temporary, because once they work it off in 7 years, they're supposed to be paid back wages and then declared free men, right? Or free woman. That is that's the common practice. So Old Testament, New Testament. And this is why it's important to understand the word, because when Jesus in Matthew 25 says, "Well done, good and faithful doulos," it's like, is he saying, "Well done, good and faithful slave"? Like your owned property to be treated as such? Or is it, "Well done, good and faithful servant"? Right? And it's translated servant because you carry that from the Hebrew, that Ebed, when Abraham is described as a servant of God, differently than those that were actual slaves. You see the difference? The context matters, and it's important, so it's very hard. So when you read that, it's important to understand what is trying to be said. Abraham was considered, was labeled as a servant of God. Joshua, a servant of God. David, a servant of God. Even the Messiah, a servant of God. So when you see that and you tie those together, is the Messiah a slave to God? No, it is a servitude, but it's different. Which brings us really to the other way to interpret it, and the way that I believe it is written here in James and intended here in James, based on the examples that Jesus gave in his teachings and using this word as well. It is a voluntary choice to be in service for life, not temporary, like you're paying off a debt, not property, like to be abused in that way, but one where you've come to and said, "I want this more than anything else." Think about that for a second. But when would someone make a choice like that? Well, it was not a very common practice, but it was common enough to where in Exodus 21, 5 through 6, there's actually a provision for this, wherein it says, if a servant comes to his master and says, "I love my master, and I don't want to go," the master will pierce his ear, and he is now in service to the master for life. It is a choice to be in service. Now, is that a slave? He's not property. Is it temporary? He's not paying off a debt. What is this? This is someone saying, this environment, this relationship is more important to me than anything else that could exist outside of this. So I'm giving up all of this and choosing you. I'm choosing to serve you. I'm choosing to be in your service. And that is what James is saying here. When he uses the term doulos, he is saying, "I love you, God, more than anything else. And I don't want to go and be of the world. I want to serve you and you alone." And God pierces our heart with the Holy Spirit, and he calls us by name. He makes us a child, adopts us into his family to protect us and to hold us close, not lording over us like property, not requiring us to pay a debt, but saying, "You are mine, and what I have is yours. The inheritance for my family, all my resources at your disposal." And the choice to serve is a choice to just be in what you believe is the greatest possible environment, the greatest possible relationship you could be in, and to sacrifice everything else. God, I serve you. Now I think about that, and I think about the choice that James made in full freedom, choosing to label himself a servant of someone that he once said was crazy. And I think, wow, how is there a better way to prove that you believe in someone, that you love them, that you cherish them, that you value them, than to serve them? listen, there's a great example to look to. One who did not account, did not count equality with God. I'm sorry, tongue tied. Let me step back for a second. Let me try that again. There is one who did not count equality with God something to be grasped, and he humbled himself. He emptied himself, became a man, and made himself what? A doulos. A servant, not a slave. Not paying off some debt that he owed to mankind. No. A doulos, a servant. What did Jesus do when he got on his knees and he went to his nasty disciples' feet and he pulled out the basin of water and the towel and he said, I'm serving you. This is what leaders do. This is the example I'm setting for you. Well, that's what James is doing. James is not just, he's giving us all these words we're going to get into as we look. He's giving us all these words about what it looks like to follow the example of Jesus. But James, in his very first verse, he says, I'm not just giving you words. I'm telling you this by my own example of choosing to change, of becoming a servant of the one I once called crazy, because I believe the one relationship that is greater than any other relationship is the one that I have with my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. See, the new normal with Jesus, it's not a thought experiment, right? It's not a subjective reality. To love Jesus is to look different, to act different, to speak different, to think different, is to choose to change. To choose faith during hard times. To choose to identify and flee from the things that tempt us. To choose not to roll our eyes at less fortunate. To choose to guard our speech, how we relate to others. To choose to guard our heart from greed and pride. To choose not to ignore the plight of others. And instead engage those around us to know them better. To know and learn better how we can love them and serve them the way Jesus did to us. Now, James hits on all of that. Every one of those topics, from speech to temptation to managing our money, to dealing with those around us that are struggling, having faith in hard times, James deals with all of it and so much more. I'm telling you, going through this book is going to be a gut punch, and you sense it because the very first verse, he comes out swinging. Hey, I've already chosen to change. Have you? That's what God wants us. He wants us to choose to change. And I think about this. I think about the times in our lives where we chose to bring in dramatic, catalytic change. Choosing that. Job, marriage, kids, whatever it is. And the things that we accepted because of that choice, could there be similar changes in our relationship with God? When you got married, you had to choose, you had to work on your communication skills. Is that something that would benefit you and your walk with Jesus to read his word, to spend time in prayer, to develop better communication skills with God? When we had kids, it disrupted our normal routines and sleep and activity. But maybe that disruption's a good thing because you establish new routines and new activities. And maybe that's what the relationship with God needs, is you to make it a priority, choose to change your routines, choose to change your habits, things that you chose to stop doing. To be a better spouse, to be a better father, to be a better coworker. That same mentality brought into your relationship with God, that you would recognize things that aren't helping you, that aren't helping your marriage, that aren't helping your household, and that you can choose to make a change for His glory, for the pursuit of holiness, and because God doesn't want us to stay the same. Now, He loves us. He loves you the way that you are. But James is saying, and I'm agreeing, that if we love God, we choose to change. You with me? Yeah. Let's pray. Father, I'm longing for the conviction and the punches in the gut and the truths to come raining in to my heart and my mind as I've been reading and studying and preparing and thinking about all the wisdom and truth that's going to come out of this book. And I pray that we allow it to break down walls, to penetrate barriers that we've put up, to try to hold on to ourselves and who we want to be in a selfish mindset, and that we would accept this truth, that we would accept the wisdom, that we would accept your word, and it would draw us to change, that would lead us into a new normal, walking away from the old, putting on the new, and standing in confidence in our faith and the joy that it brings and the peace, the hope. Words that we say often and we flout because your word gives us that. But may this study, may the time we spend in James bring it all to the surface in our heart and our mind, so we see that it is real. It's not some idea that we can't grab a hold of, that it's there waiting for us, that you, God, are the greatest thing that's ever happened to us, that you are the relationship we should value more than anything else, that you are the one we should choose to serve above all else. May we choose to change for you. And we pray all that in Jesus' name. Amen. The band's going to come out. We're going to sing. We're going to close in a time of worship and response. And this is the moment that I challenge you to let the Holy Spirit grab hold of what He's already begun to form in your heart and your mind. You begin to think about where you could change. Choosing to change your speech, choosing to change the opinion about those around you, choosing to change and your heart as it involves greed or pride or whatever it is. And the Holy Spirit's speaking to you. And what you've got going on in your life right now, that you would take this moment as we sing these songs, as the Spirit of God moves in this place and moves in our hearts, that you would listen and let Him say, this is where I need you to choose to change. And then you choose. And then you change. Let's do it. Let's sing.